Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon, or if you're joining us on the recording, hello. My name is James Borner. I'm from Jellyfish, and Jellyfish is a digital marketing partner helping brands and companies through digital executions from planning, media, strategy, and execution.
Hi there, good morning. Gavin SD, I'm from United Virtualities. We are the e-commerce experts, and we're ready to help you drive your e-commerce experience forward. Please drop your questions in the chat, and towards the end of the presentation, we'll be able to respond to each and every one of you. So let's get started. There are 1.8 million e-commerce destinations now in 2020. And those 1.8 million destinations are competing for a market share of about $600 billion. Not only that, but all of the digital marketing spend in the US now accounts for about $130 billion. This is now a very competitive market. There's a lot of customers, there's a lot of marketers, there's a lot of sites all competing for each other's eyeballs. It used to be back when a lot of us got started with e-commerce that it was true, if you build it, they will come. This is not true anymore. It's really about how to figure out how to get the best value for those marketing dollars. How do you convert those customers to your site? How do you convert the visitors to customers? How do you take customers and turn them into repeat customers? And it's really
Exactly.
about, go ahead, James.
Exactly. And it's all about protecting that investment as well. It's not only getting that first purchase, getting that site visit, but it's also encouraging people to join, become entrenched with your brand and build up that relationship that large brands love with their clients to encourage that repeat business and really, really start to capitalize on your marketing expenditure. And like, this is it. This is what we really need to do to be able to achieve this. There's a lot of technology and a lot of platforms in marketing. We need to bring it all together to get from that starting point through to having a long and hopefully prosperous relationship with your consumers.
When we look at the Martech and Adtech landscape, you can kind of break down each of the different parts of your platform into one of these categories. Is it a website? Is it your content management system? And so on. And it used to be the case that we were very keen on building capabilities. Can you add new analytics? Can you add a box that improves your communications, your Adtech execution, and so on? But really, it comes down to one thing. The arrows are more important than the boxes. Integrating marketing platforms gives you the power to really drive your business forward and really to build innovative e-commerce and marketing experiences. And we're going to talk about some of the Salesforce offerings. Commerce Cloud is about seamless e-commerce experiences. Marketing Cloud helps you create seamless experiences for your marketing across various touch points. Service Cloud is about service, responding rapidly to customers, being able to have your agents really help customers and turn them from unhappy customers to happy customers. And Sales Cloud is the Salesforce we all know and love, those powerful CRM platforms that really helps you sell. However, today we're really going to be focusing on that Commerce Cloud and Marketing Cloud areas.
Exactly. And in a crowded digital world, the picture that Gavin painted before with a lot of money on the table and a lot of people investing to get there, by looking at these platforms and connecting them and in get our customers to our site or to start to know our brand and to start to ask for us to appear into a consideration set. All of this is very important, and we've been trying to unpick that on the marketing side for ages. But by connecting your e-commerce and your marketing platforms, we can start to really realize the dream, which is to provide consumers a consolidated, trackable, measurable experience with our marketing activities, and then be able to pass the baton over to our e-commerce platforms and actually really make the products we put in front of them, the site experience, our follow-up communications, everything that we do to increase the order value, conversion rates, etc., make that a beautiful, seamless experience. So it's fantastic for us, but actually, as well, it's time now in 2020 that we make sure that we give our clients and our customers the best experiences that we can, all the way through our marketing touch points and onto our site. And the only way that we can achieve that is through this connected ecosystem that Gavin's described before. And the one thing, the three things that we're gonna really focus on, and like, let's be honest, the three core pillars of marketing and e-com activity is to gain more customers, to increase the conversions from those customers, and of course, to increase the value that we get from those guys as well. So it becomes very important to be able to connect the platforms. So this is what we're gonna focus on today.
I always joke that everything I always learned about marketing, I learned from one movie, Glengarry Glen Ross. And it really comes down to one thing, AIDA. And I think about this in terms of e-commerce funnels, awareness, interest, decision, action. You're trying to get customers to follow a journey down this from awareness, being aware of your brand, interest, to being looking at a product detail page and engaging with a product. The decision, being able to add a product to the cart and really start that checkout and decision-making journey. And action, really completing that order. And we're going to look at three of those journeys today, starting at the bottom from cart abandonment. How do you turn those customers that fail to complete those transactions into customers? How do you give them the nudge that they need to really turn them into a customer? It's a very competitive marketplace, as we've talked about. There's a lot of people chasing those e-commerce dollars. How do you make sure you're the one that gets it? And it's really about the integration between the commerce cloud and marketing cloud technologies. How do you join data from one area to another? And we really want to make sure that when the customer adds some items to their cart and then doesn't check out, that action is captured and makes it to marketing cloud so we can put that shopper on a journey. And once they're on a journey, we can then engage with them based on what channel makes sense. Does it make sense to send them an email? Does it make sense to engage with them through SMS? Does it make sense to engage with them through ad tech or Facebook or some other kind of channels? And in this case, like, how do we take those customers and turn them into an email and turn that email into an action?
Exactly. And by joining these things, this is exactly what we start to realize. And we're going to look through the lens of Salesforce predominantly today, but at Jellyfish, we can help you look at all of your disparate platforms and provide consultation around how we can sew that journey together for you, as with Gavin and United Ventures as well. So one thing we'll look at is I'll be mentioning some activation. And one thing that Salesforce has is a great link to the Google Marketing Platform, so you can start to join your offsite and on-site activities together, and of course be able to activate, understand, segment, analyze across Google, across Facebook, across Salesforce and your site as well. So what Gavin was describing, let's take a look at what this looks like for a consumer. And again, you know, if you're a typical marketer, you're probably running some display work. You're very likely to be running search activity to capture that demand that has been generated by any PR, any brand lover you've got, and of course that display work. And then these things working together, hopefully we get somebody to come and visit our site. So the point is that there's a lot of investment happening before we even start to get our customers to our sites. And once they're there, of course, like anybody with an ascent marketing program will be then trying to protect that marketing investment a little bit with some retargeting work. So once somebody's gone away, hopefully they come back to their site, we might get them back in. And like now we're looking at products and somebody's got something in their basket. And now just like thinking about that investment, we've got all of this stuff that we've just described before, which has just got somebody to this point. But the platforms that we're using now, investment in your conversion rate optimization, your user experience, the e-commerce platform on its site alone, unless we have these things linked, we're not going to be able to realize that investment so easily. So once somebody's got something into their basket as well, sometimes, maybe all too often, maybe part of the journey, we get a little bit of silence. So this is where the link between commerce platforms and marketing platforms becomes incredibly, incredibly powerful. And just a simple step and a very effective one is just being able to link these two things together to start to nudge a person along that journey a little bit farther as well. We're Jellyfish. We've got United Ventures. The one product that we came up with was United Jelly Beans. So like, this is our hypothetical cart, but very easily from the signals that have been taken up until this point, we can set up an email to broadcast out to users that fit this bucket, just to encourage them to come along and finish checking out whatever was in their basket. So simple cart abandonment email. And of course, in the utopian land of marketing, this results in a sale. So well done, everybody. And within a platform like Salesforce, actually, we can start to sketch out what these journeys and interactions might be, and actually start to test, refine, and understand what touch points we would want to deliver to users to help people through that journey. And it can be different for different assortments, different categories, different verticals. If I've got multiple products, multiple services that I'm selling, or it can be more linear if you've got a more simple product assortment, for example. And that was a kind of simple look through about how we can just connect those channels and use email to encourage. But actually, if you're in a more competitive marketplace or you're slightly more mature as a brand, we can start to easily combine the channels that we're using here. So again, we've got our marketing investment that we've done just to get somebody to our site. In this scenario, there's something in the basket. We can follow up with our email. And if that's not really getting us the results we wanted, or maybe we're not seeing the open rates with that email broadcast that we might expect or want, we can invoke a display medium. So to further reach out to those customers and encourage that conversion. So again, for slightly more advanced people, we can start to capitalize on multiple channels to be able to reach our users in a more effective way. And that's linear, but imagine that you're in a very competitive marketplace, or you are in a peak season and your industry is very competitive at this time of year. You might want to invoke these things concurrently. So you might want to unleash the email, you might want to follow up with some display, and you might want to deliver those display ads over your Facebook platform as well. Of course, that results in a sale, congratulations, but we're tying together these disparate mediums with a consistent message which is unique to that user. So this becomes a very powerful tool in providing those seamless journeys.
And not just those seamless journeys, but those journeys need to be personalized and make sense for that customer. We really need to go beyond making a website for everyone. We need to be making a website for each individual customer. And this really was where the integration between Commerce and Marketing Cloud lives. Getting those shopper events into Marketing Cloud, being able to run the Marketing Cloud predictive intelligence, Einstein, being able to generate recommendations with Personalization Builder, so that you can really understand what sort of products the customer's interested in, tie it to their order history, their cart, and then be able to get recommendations that make sense to them. Because without those personalized recommendations, you're just sending out generic emails like everybody else.
Exactly. And that does not quite work these days. Like, people, consumers, whether they know it or not, I think, to be fair, kind of expect a level of personalization. And there's a lot of data that shows that it actually really does make sense and work. And within the Salesforce platform, for example, there's a tool called Einstein, which is their collective term for all of their artificial intelligence. But you can use this very easily to unlock being able to unlock personalization at some kind of scale. So you've got Einstein, it's a personalization engine. So when we think about increasing the value that we get from our marketing investment, and when we think about having more value from the users that we've started this relationship with, a recommendation for follow-up sales becomes like the obvious choice, and it's a short step to do. So something like Embracing Einstein can easily start to email people for follow-up purchases, and depending on what the AI defines your audience as, maybe you're more of a gourmet, it deems, and you would an email for a slightly more sophisticated product would resonate with you really well. Or if you're like me, I'm sad to say, probably something a little more gluttonous, and it might recommend a very large tub of jelly beans. But either way, just adding that kind of adding that element of personalization based on collection of site interactions and your previous conversion data is a very powerful tool indeed, just to start on that journey of encouraging that relationship between you and your consumers.
Great. And I think one of the things that we as e-commerce and marketers do, we have this love-hate relationship with coupons. Like, we want to be very aware that we're not training our customers to get discounts from us and look for those discounts. But on the other hand, coupons are an extremely valuable way to give personalized offers to our customers. And I think that we have to be careful that we don't use generic coupons. We can really use them in a way that engages with customers and gives them that personalized touch. And again, this integration between Commerce Cloud and Marketing Cloud, where we can ingest coupons and put customers on a journey that they can engage with emails and then complete their purchase, we can really send them a coupon that relates to something that is valid. Instead of giving them a flat 25% off all products, they could you could give them free shipping on their favorite product category. You could give them the next best action that really is going to send them on a new journey that's going to be the most amount of sales for your business. So in this case, it's that you're not getting a generic message. You are getting a product code, coupon code that is really related to a product that you may purchase. And this exactly. really kind of personalized use of promotions is key, just to not use them as a way to just discount all of your products.
Exactly. And if you do this right, of course, it results in a perfect sale. And when we look at this as well, again, that's an easy step to do, and it makes a big difference. It's the equivalent of a kind of low-hanging fruit. But if you're slightly more advanced, or, you know, again, if your marketplace is a little more competitive, you can start to combine these concepts that we've spoken about together. So in this instance, yes, we can start to push somebody along that journey and give them the encouragement they need with the email. But if we're not getting an open rate again, or maybe that's not getting the conversion rates that we kind of want, we can unleash an additional medium. So maybe this is display, and which, you know, by transferring, by being able to, by the integration between these platforms, we can identify who's opened the email, who hasn't. We can push the people that haven't into the Google Marketing platform, for example, or Facebook, to be able to execute and show them display ads. Still, if we're not getting what we want, we might want to follow up with an actual email that has an offer in. So to Gavin's point, you know, we're not, it's not, doesn't become a race to the bottom. Actually, we're using our tools in our toolbox and the channels at our disposal to encourage people along. And if that doesn't work, then we kind of get the last resort to start to offer a discount as well. So actually, from our point of view as marketers, it's us doing everything we can to secure our sales, to protect all of our marketing and technology investments that we had beforehand to get to have that conversation with our consumer. And then if we're not getting what we think, we can go down the route of offering a discount. And of course, that results in sales. Well done. Now, a big part of this as well is you might not want to give the same offer to every group of people. You're likely going to know through site signals, maybe through some past purchase activity, through looking at your other users and what happens in your CRM. Maybe you only want to give discounts to people that you're going to transpire to be high net worth customers, people that are showing signals of becoming having longevity in their relationship with you. And the audience builder tool, the advertising audiences in Salesforce, allows you to segment and do this and select specific people to get specific types of offer. So maybe that's a discount, or maybe it's just free shipping, maybe it's the things that they've looked at or not. So it's not a blanket tool. It doesn't have to be. You can segment out and make sure that you're actually only discounting to people that you're going to actually unlock the real value in the longer term of your relationship.
And while we move on and start throwing out all of these ideas around marketing, we get to this problem of, like, what do we actually do? Have you ever sat in one of your meetings with your team and there's just everyone has a bunch of competing ideas? How do we validate which of those ideas is the best idea to use? Say, for example, a buy one, get one free offer versus a buy two items, get free shipping item. How do you test out and prove which of your marketing efforts is going to have the biggest impact. How do you use data and observations to really have hypothesis-driven optimization? And we really want to move to an idea of, we believe this because this is what we think, to we believe this because this is what the data shows us. And we're able to go through these steps of experimenting and evaluating different options to really optimize the site and optimize our marketing effort and spend. So when we look at A/B testing in Commerce Cloud, we have a rich set of features. We can test against three main areas: promotions, content slots, and sorting rules. Promotions are about what kind of discounts make sense to the customer. Content rules is what kind of content resonates most with the content. Does a video about your product versus a banner, what kind of products that you are promoting make most sense? And I guess sorting rules is the easiest one. What order of products on the page is going to have the biggest impact? So you're able to go in to the online marketing section, click on A/B tests, and then manage these A/B tests and configure how you'd like them to run. You can run this buy one, get one 50% off versus buy two, free shipping, tie offers to these promotions and these different buckets of customers, and really figuring out which of these two approaches makes most sense and generates the most sales.
Yep, and unsurprisingly, because we're talking about connectivity, joining channels, joining medias, of course you can start to test the things in the marketing world that kind of make sense. So this can be testing of site experiences, the content that you serve to your consumers, whether an arrangement of content on a page makes more sense or not, whether the arrangement of a content in an email or a message makes more sense or not, and test out different ways of presenting data and offers to people. And of course, finally, like testing, the big one is testing the channels, the media channels that you're actually executing through and starting and continuing those conversations with your consumers across. And like when we look at the Salesforce Cloud, Marketing Cloud, again, this makes it simple to run concurrent, multiple split tests. So you can look at running all of those items, understanding what works. And as Gavin says, like, we're very lucky, we're very fortunate. We have speed to insight. We can test our hypotheses. Previously, in a non-digital world, you'd be looking at a 3-month, 6-month cycle to be able to even find results over your media laydown, your media executions, and to see whether what works or what doesn't when you're testing individually in different regions or running geo tests like that. Now we have the luxury of knowing almost instantaneously what's going to work, what doesn't, and we can capitalize that and keep on refining and tweaking and going forwards.
So don't take our word for it. I wanted to kind of give four examples of A/B testing and the impact it had on conversion. Improving the design of a mini cart call to action, getting people to understand that they want to check out versus just look at their cart. Conversion up 7.1%. Product page, being very clear about your selling point. If you're going to offer free returns and free shipping, make sure that you are going to tell your customers that. Big hint around there, free returns doesn't generally make more returns. It's a great selling point. Think Zappos. Conversion up 12.3%. Product page, increasing the visibility of options. Have you ever looked at buying a t-shirt and you don't get to see what the t-shirt looks like in the color you're trying to pick? It's a terrible user experience. Fixing those kind of issues, conversion up 17%. Homepage. This is always the controversial thing. Our customers like banners more than our customers like banners. Removing the hero banner, conversion up 43%.
I absolutely love that one. In fact, I love all of those because like there's a degree of counterintuitivism in all of those points. So they illustrate so well that yes, we have to test.
And not only is that, it's like what you have to think about from a customer's point of view, what happens after I place my order? It's the battle isn't win there. I don't know about you, but as soon as my order is placed, I'm waiting at the door with bated breath for my package to come in the mail. This is this area, this chasm of fear, if you will, the chasm of uncertainty. When is it going to come? Did I buy something that I really wanted? Can I afford it? You have to win this battle after the sale too. And I always tell people this is the big advantage of Amazon Prime. 2-day shipping reduces this window of customer unhappiness as much as possible. And you also have to look at it as not in that time, do you really want to contact your customer and send them more marketing one? As an example, last November, just before Thanksgiving, I got an offer saying, as a VIP customer, you can buy from us and beat the Black Friday rush. However, on Black Friday, the product I got was cheaper than I already had it. It didn't really make me feel like a VIP anymore. And by the time that product came a couple of weeks later, I was already mad about that thing, and it wasn't the experience it could have been.
Right, that's awful. And like, and who doesn't experience the kind of buyer's remorse once in a while that Gavin was mentioning? Like, that's absolutely true. And like, that experience illustrates this wonderfully. I took this quote from Kevin A. Plank, who is the founder CEO of Under Armour. I actually think I heard it from somebody else, but my memory doesn't serve me very well. But when you're talking about consumer love, consumer trust, and consumer loyalty, it's something that you build in drips, in teaspoons. You're filling a large bucket, but one foul step and you lose the whole thing in one go. So like, we've really got to make sure that every interaction counts. We're thinking about our marketing communications. And the key thing with everything, whether it's marketing initiatives that are happening offsite, stuff when you're communicating with your customers when they're in the sales flow, suppression is one of the most important and powerful tools that we can ever use. Suppression protects your marketing spend, like removing people that have been to your site and know your brand from some of your higher funnel, mid funnel marketing work, obviously frees up a lot more budget to go and spend on net new customers and people that haven't been exposed to your brand. It's a no-brainer. I mention it because it's remarkable how many people don't do this. But in this parlance, as somebody's gone through and become a customer, you need to suppress them out of marketing activity. And as Gavin says, who wants to receive a discount message for a product that they've just bought? Like it, you know, all of this contributes to how people perceive and feel and understand your brand. So coming towards the end now, like, one way that we like to look at this and to look at a brand's communication, the platforms that they use and their degree of connectivity and how, of course, they become successful is the digital maturity framework. This one belongs to the Boston Consulting Group. It's a very powerful tool, framework for understanding where you are across your channels, across your marketing activity, quantifying what you might need to do next, running some gap analysis, and giving yourself a roadmap to move forwards. It's in a medium, in a channel that's as sprawling and has as many moving parts as digital, actually this becomes really valuable. And everything that Gavin and I have just spoken through, that connectivity piece, you know, you'd be surprised how many companies, big brands, don't do this as well as they could do and arguably should do. And just having these connections, your CRM and your e-commerce platform talking to your marketing and your advertising technology platforms, like, this puts you squarely in the connected phase. This is good stuff. Like, this is something that you need to embrace, or we encourage you to embrace, to understand, and to pull the trigger on. And we're always happy to talk through how we can make that a reality for you.
Yeah, I think the big thing that we really want to talk about, these integrated platforms for integrated marketing, is we're moving away from this old thinking about building capabilities. Organizations always used to say, we need more capabilities, we need to be able to do more things. But it's now that we have these platforms that can do a lot of things, and integrating Commerce Cloud and Marketing Cloud and Google gives you so much capabilities, it's really changing to focusing on those capabilities, focusing on integrated platforms and integrating your efforts to really focus on execution, being able to really have speed to market, being able to have something happen. We remember from the beginning of March when COVID-19 really hit, and every single one of your inboxes was probably filled with boring marketing messages. Like, how do you really execute well and execute when something like that changes? Like, how do you find out if your crazy idea is really crazy without good execution? And these really connecting these platforms is about protecting your investment and getting more value out of it.
Exactly. And then back to our three sort of core pillars of e-commerce and marketing activity. By doing this, it's a simple way to future-proof your organization, but also to increase your conversion rates, your value of, from your consumers, and of course, the number of sales that you achieve. And let's not forget, at the heart of everything should be being able to provide better experiences to your consumers and to your existing and soon-to-be customers. Now, speaking of customer journeys, you're all customers of ours potentially. You are on your own journey, and it looks a little bit like this. Right now, if you stay tuned until this point, you're in the green box at the bottom right hand of the screen. The next phase, we'll share the content and follow up, but you're welcome to reach out to Gavin or myself, where we can start to have a conversation about how we can make this work for you within your organization.
Perfect. And thank you so much for attending today.
Yeah, we totally appreciate your time. And we've got some time left for a Q&A session. So if anybody has anything, let's go. Okay, I've got one here. So Google and other platforms have been following me around for the last few years, showing me very personalized ads. But now there are more and more privacy laws like the CCPA and browsers eliminating third-party cookies. Does it seem to you that over the upcoming years, it will be easier or harder for this sort of integrated marketing to follow me around? Okay, meaty question, straight to the heart of everything that's important right now. But we won't shy away from it. So the cookie thing and the privacy thing, they're very interrelated, but let's start with the privacy piece. You need to make sure that you're obtaining permission to be able to communicate to your consumers. You need to make sure that you're using ad technology that can capture that permission and suppress people out from your marketing communications or not as fit. That's vitally important. The next piece is the cookie. Most advertising technology is actually completely run on the cookie, as we know, but there's a few that have a different ID graph that's based on logged in user information that they can access across different sites. There's a few players. Facebook, for example, Google, for example, through Chrome, through Android, through search, maps, everything else. Salesforce, indeed, one as well, being born out of your own data. So if you're working with one of those partners, you're not going to be so affected by the loss of cookies. They're going to switch over to a different way of identifying people that is completely privacy and user-centric at its core. One of the good thing about working with these kind of companies is where they put a foot wrong, governments take note, legislation gets written. You're not going to put yourself at risk. Sometimes it's some of the other ad tech players that might expose their customers a little bit more. So you just need to have complete diligence that you can still be able to rate your people, and you're using a platform that can facilitate that.
Yeah, I think I come back to that boxes and arrows point earlier, which is the connections between your platforms are often more important than the platforms themselves. And I think when you look at your choice between choosing several a small number of integrated platforms or a large number of possibly best in breed ones and integrate them, the second option dramatically expands the number of cookies that you're trying to get and the number of connections you're trying to make with that data. So really focusing on a small number of integrated platforms, I think is going to be the way to future-proof some of these cookie issues we're seeing.
Yeah, and we've got another question, but just to ride on Gavin's coattails there a little bit as well. If you think about Google, you think about Salesforce, you've got your CRM and all your customer data, you've got your email communications, and if you think about Google, you've got your next step in that journey, which is like which is search, which is arguably one of the most important acquisitive channels. If you marry that with Facebook and the other parts of the Google platform, you can do all of your display work as well. So they're a really good set of technologies to have. Second question. Implementing this entire integration will always be expensive. Is the one part that you think is the most important to make the full integration affordable? Yeah, good question again.
I think I could look at that question and say it doesn't have to be expensive. And I think the the ease of integration of some of these platforms is really the difference between something that is expensive and something that's not. And then moving from the basic integration is how do you really use it and then derive value from it? And I think that the concept around like crawl, walk, run, like start to use your marketing platform to do a small amount of messaging, then move to cross-channel execution and kind of build on top of those capabilities one by one until you are the master of all channels and all of your data is really the way forward. And I think that then that changes that investment over a big lump sum that then you throw a expensive tool over the fence to your marketers to you, to something that you build up over time and really start to get value out of as you start to use it more.
Yeah, exactly that. I totally agree. The only thing the marketer inside me wants to say, well, there's an opportunity cost of not doing it, but that's just not a really, that's not a great answer. So yeah, it's iterations, it's chunks. It's looking at something using a framework like the Digital Maturity Framework to highlight where you might need to put some attention and resource first, and then just keep on building on those foundations. Cool. Well, it looks like that might be all we've got. Yeah, fantastic. Okay, well, in that case, from our side at Jellyfish, we're thrilled that you could make the time to be with us. We hope we shared some concepts that are useful and inspiring to you. And please reach out and we can let you know how to make these concepts a reality for your organization.
Definitely. Thank you for everyone at UV. And we definitely want to be part of the next conversation of how do we do e-commerce better.
Yeah. And also, finally, thank you, Gavin, especially for coping with the technical difficulties. That was fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thanks, James.
Bye-bye.